That would be fine. You could do that too. Serves 360. That's why I do it.
Thank you. your letter forms if you are doing the spring play and spring sports people, turn in your sports fees. The third quarter ends next Friday. And there is a fundraiser at Yoga Beach in Carson tomorrow from 2 to 7. And it's a fundraiser for a little girl named Maya who has leukemia that I know. So please go and support her if you can. The baby bottle fundraiser that NHS is doing, please remember to fill up those bottles with change. The baby bottle should be in the class advisor's room. So fill those up. Please pray. Dear Heavenly Father, God, we thank you for this day. I pray that you would just be with us all as we worship you, and that we would remember what these lyrics mean and what you do for us every day, God. I pray that you would just be with us as we go through the rest of the day, and that you be with our speaker today, that you would be in his words, God, and that they would not be his own. In Jesus' name.
I'm
for the opportunity to come together and worship you. And I ask that you just give me a message today and that you help us to remember that we can use these words and that you've given us these words in our daily lives. And I ask that you just help us have a good week and continue to push through and work through it. In your name I pray. Amen.
That he had to be somebody that came from God. But he didn't quite understand what that all meant. He couldn't quite figure out who Jesus really was and what it meant. So in order to try to help Nicodemus better understand, he tells a story that Nicodemus recognized. Nicodemus, as a Jewish leader, would be very familiar with what was the Bible at that time. It's our Old Testament today. At that time, that was the Bible. He would be very familiar with the Bible and all that had happened in there. So when he would tell this story about Moses and the children of Israel, Nicodemus would know what he's talking about. He would understand. And the story he's talking about is that the children of Israel, if you recall, had been in slavery in Egypt, and God wanted to take them out of slavery, hearing their cries for freedom. And so he sent Moses to take them out. And they went through the Red Sea, through the parting of the water, and they got out into the night mountain, out into the Sinai Desert and Peninsula, and they were wandering around out there, heading out towards the Promised Land. The children of Israel became very disgruntled with God. They were tired of being in the desert. They were tired of this manna and quail. They were tired of just wandering, it seemed as though, and what was happening. And they began to question God, began to wonder whether God really was going to do what he said he was going to do. And because they began to grumble and doubt God, etc., he sent snakes, poisonous snakes, amongst the camp. They began to bite the people, and they would die. The people realized that this was a punishment from God, realized what they were doing was wrong, and so they go to Moses and say, Moses, will you please pray for us? We recognize we've sinned against God. Please pray that God will do something for us. And so God prays to God. Moses prays to God, and he asks for relief for the children. And so Moses says, tell you what, take a bronze snake, make a bronze snake, and put it on a pole and set it up in the middle of the camp. And tell the people that if they look that bronze snake, they will be saved from their snake bite. And so the children of Israel, when they were bit, if they believed that was going to be true, they would look at the snake and they would be saved. For those who thought, oh man, that can't possibly, and if they didn't look at the snake, they would die. And so Jesus says, just as Moses raised that snake up, and if the people looked to that snake and believed, they would be saved. So me, the Son of God, the one who's going to be the Messiah, will one day have to also be lifted up onto the cross. And on that cross, I will take the sins of the entire world, your sins, my sins, of everybody who's ever lived. And I will pay the price on that cross. I will have to suffer and die, and I will have to experience what it means to be separated from God. Because that's the punishment that our sins should have. But those who will look to me and believe that I died for their sins will have the gift of eternal life. And so Jesus said, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. The punishment for our sins is to be separated from God. God is perfect and holy. He cannot tolerate sin. And if we were left in our sins, we would be separated from God. And that's what hell is. Hell is being separated from God. You and I, an unbeliever, no person ever on this world has ever understood, except for Jesus, what it means to be separated from God, because God does not take his presence away from us while we are alive on earth. But if we die in our sins and haven't accepted the forgiveness that God gives to us that was earned for us on the cross, we will be separated from eternity from God. That's what hell is all about. But God doesn't want that. He wants us to be with him forever, for eternity. And that's why he sent his Son, to take our sins and pay the price for those sins. That's why died for us. That's why he ran and was hung on the tree. The cross is the most important symbol of the Christian faith. Because when you look to the cross, you are reminded of what Christ has done for you. For me. It reminds us that we have the gift of eternal life. That's what Jesus has done for us. But how do we know that? How do we know that to be true? No, Demas was wondering what this was all about. There are times when I think about how amazing God is, and I think about all that He's done, and I think about sending His Son, and I think about all those things, and I wonder, can that really be true? And then I think of the cross. And I know it to be true. I know it to be true because God's Word tells us that. And you may say, well, how do we know that? Let me ask you a question. How many of you believe that there was a Roman emperor? Why do you believe that? Evidence. Yeah. Mrs. Bader told you that? All right, Mrs. Bader, wow, you got a power. No, we believe that because we have books of history that talk about the Roman Empire, right? How many of you have been to Rome? Some of you, I know, have been there. Did you see a thing called the Colosseum? Isn't that where the gladiators fought? Didn't that tell us it was a Roman Empire? That's true of Israel, too. You know, recently, not too long ago, they found, there's a guy if you read the Passion story, and if you hear it in the next days ahead as we come up to the Holy Week, etc., there's a guy by the name of Caiaphas, who was one of the leaders who was a part of all of the trials to have Jesus condemned so that he could be crucified, etc. They found Caiaphas' grave. The man existed. They found his grave. And if you go over there, you will find places after place of ancient times that collaborate what we find in Scripture about places and people and things. There are secular historians who talk about places and people and things that are found in Scripture. That isn't just some book that was written. We believe in the Roman Empire because of the histories written, and yet there's 10,000 times more evidence for the Scripture being true than there is for the Roman histories. It's true. Because history says it's true. But more importantly, it's true because God has told us in His Word that it's true. And in that Word, He tells us why it's important. For He says, for God so loved the world. You know who that is? It's you. You can say that verse, for God so loved me, or put your name in there. God wants you to be with Him. In our discipleship groups, we've been talking about identity in Christ. If you go back to one of the first ones we talked about, how does God see you? He sees you as His special child. But most importantly, He sees you as His special child, redeemed by the blood of His Son, Jesus Christ, who is with us. And He wants you to be with Him for eternity. And so when we see or hear about John 3:16, may it remind us. When we see the cross, may it remind us of how privileged we are to have a God who loves us so much that He would sacrifice His one and only Son so that we could be with Him for eternity. And that's what heaven is all about, being with God. And there isn't anything better than that. Think about the one person in your life that you would most like to be with. Isn't that great? Isn't that fun when you be with them? Well, guess what? Being with God for eternity is going to make that look like nothing. That is what makes it so special. It's my hope and prayer for me and each and every one of you that we will never stop looking at the cross and accepting that precious gift of eternal life that Jesus has given us. In a few weeks, we will celebrate Easter. His resurrection tells us that that is true. There's a movie out called Risen. I encourage you to listen. It's fantastic. Because it's told from the view of a Roman soldier who did not believe that Christ had risen, that the body had been stolen. And he goes about trying to find that body, trying to find what really happened on that Sunday morning. It's pretty amazing when you find out. Go and see it. It's great. Because it reassures us again that Jesus is alive. He's at the right hand of God. And one day you and I will be there too because of us. Lord God, Heavenly Father, thank you for loving us, each and every one of us, as a unique child of yours, so much that you give your son on our behalf to die for us. Help us to always remember that. May your Holy Spirit empower us every day to have that trust. And when we doubt, to look to the cross and again be reminded of what he's done for us. Help us to go to your word, because there we are reassured again and again of how powerful your love is. Also, let us be bold and courageous in being able to share that same love with those around us. We pray that the Lord hears us in His precious name.
pray for the fundraiser tomorrow, is we help this little girl who has been being a little bit. We won't just help raise money, Lord, but for the family, we'll help raise encouragement. Lord, I just pray that we go throughout this day, that we just kind of remember our own things as they said, Lord. And I pray this in your name. Amen.
Times in life, we can begin to kind of take some things for granted, and there are things in our life that are important, and they're there for a purpose, etc. But we begin to let our old sinful nature kind of